Welcome to a Fresh Perspective podcast, catering to the latest in ingredient trends, consumer insights, and food news. Brought to you by Corbion.
Hello, and welcome to a Fresh Perspective podcast, the podcast where we talk about everything food. I'm Jenny Kolzer, your host, and today I'm joined by the lovely Marge O'Brien.
Hi, Jenny.
Hello. So this podcast, we're actually going to talk about a look forward in the baking industry for 2022. But as we all know, we can only look forward by looking back. So I'm excited to introduce our guests today, and I think we should jump right in. What do you think?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so today we're joined by Jonna Parker. She's the team lead for IRI Fresh, and Anna Marie Roerink, and she is the president of 210 Analytics. Welcome again, ladies.
Thanks for having me here.
We're happy to have you back, like always. So let's start things by talking about the fresh bakery aisle, because in 2021, everyone said, you know, bakery is back. But is that the real story, Jonna?
Yeah, you know, we are seeing elevated sales units and dollars versus 2019, which is my belief of strength in the in-store bakery. What happened in 2020, as mostly everyone listening knows or intuitively can guess, is that not only was labor a problem, you know, we weren't having as many people crushed in the back of the store to put things out or bake things, but also we weren't shopping with browsing in mind. We also weren't going to our offices or schools. And so that immediacy of maybe that fresh, beautiful donut wasn't as relevant to us last year. In 2021, there is more celebrations, especially smaller. And like, you know, if you're going to now have grandma and the aunts and uncles over for the first time in forever, you're going to want to put something out that everyone can grab and snack on. You're going to want it to be beautiful, and you're going to want it to be exciting. In-store bakery is there for that. I think there was also a trend that people didn't anticipate, although we kind of knew from past situations where folks were at home a lot. The higher end and more premium options for breads and rolls that were only available in the consumer's mind in the in-store bakery have really done well throughout the lockdown period, the last 20 months or so. And so I think when you think it's back, we're still at a much higher rate than 2019, and we're only back from what was frankly not the reason of the bakery or the consumers not wanting to buy it. Our lives were just different in spring, summer, 2020. And now our lives are this new normal that really favors the reasons to buy from fresh bakery.
So Anna Marie, let me ask you, building on that, when we say that, you know, in-store bakery is back, I often also think about the aisle and just bakery overall. And the pandemic has forced people to eat at home. And as a result, bakery has really seen that uptick. So moving forward, how does bakery keep those consumers coming back?
Super good question. And I actually want to bring in another aisle, and that's the baking aisle, where you might find all the items to make items at home. Because I think that is a key part of this story. Initially, much like we were very enthusiastic to cook our own meals, everybody was baking too. You might remember there was not a pack of flour, sugar, yeast to be found, and probably everybody on your Facebook and Instagram was sending you pictures of breads that they made, cookies they made. I never got into that one, but point being, baking is back to normal, and that means that in-store bakery is also getting a lot more of the business relative to the cupcakes and the cookies and all the items that for a while people were making themselves. So I think in part, that is also the opportunity to keep shoppers in both the in-store bakery and the aisle, is really understanding what are those different consumption occasions, which ones are still at home, which ones are ones that people buy in the store, which ones are ones they want to create themselves. And so I think it's very much a consumer forward approach to keeping the business than a product forward approach. And with it, the different consumption occasions. A lot of the nation's school children are back in school. Mm-hmm. Does that provide a lunchbox opportunity? Some people are still working from home. We know there's a lot of pressure on lunch. Is that an opportunity? But you have to ideate, and you have to make sure that people understand And just simply think about these different options that are available when that consumption occasion rolls around.
I'm curious, what do you think in terms of other parts of the store? What do you find to be those categories that you take inspiration from and that maybe we as bakeries should look toward?
I'll take that one first because I'll throw out something that is probably not, I think Anne-Marie threw out some amazing ones. I'd say, how have we not looked more at the power bar aisle? It's become an aisle. It has become an aisle.
Yes.
Of individually wrapped functional foods with sweets. 10 years ago, that would have been the bastion of the baking aisle and the fresh perimeter. And yet we don't think about that at all. And I think the reason there's certainly been suppliers and retailers who have tried to launch a fresh or fresher power bar style item. And I say power bar, but also, you know, there are granola bars. I mean, that has just exploded. There's been so many other both morning, afternoon, and snack kind of this, you know, natural food aisle. It's an aisle now. And you would have thought that that would have been just immediately an inspiration for in-store bakery. And when folks have launched those types of items in their perimeter bakery, even their baked goods aisle, they haven't always been met with success, even though the product tests well out of the store. The reason is because the people who are walking down those functional food aisles don't even think about the in-store bakery except at that special occasion. And so if you're going to launch this fantastic item, which if you think about has done so well at local coffee shops and also farmers markets and subscription boxes to be fresher and cleaner than maybe what's in the pre-pack aisle, you've got to do a pull strategy to bring those people into perimeter bakery. Now, the reality, and I just did a study for someone this past week that really reemphasized, even in 2021, with all the new buyers we've seen into baked goods and all the change the aisle's done, as well as the perimeter, it's still the heaviest one-third of shoppers, meaning the most who spend the most and are the most loyal to a retailer's perimeter bakery. The average age is 68.
Wow. Oh my goodness.
And it becomes, and it's been something I've talked about. I've been in bakery for 2 decades now, and it's been something we've talked about forever, right, Marge? Is, you know, because of so many items in that in-store bakery that drive frequency are typically your turnovers, your Danishes, your donuts, and also the types of meals, you know, the idea of having 3 square meals and then also having like a protein, a starch, and a bread, you know, and a starch is so synonymous with baby boomers. All of those things really make it hard for an in-store bakery retailer to move away into something that's maybe more aimed at a millennial or a Gen Z, a functional food. So it feels risky. And yet there is so much white space opportunity. Again, if you bring in items that are maybe looking at those power bar inspiration type things, but then drive consumers into that aisle and let them know you have it. So that's the big trend I wanted to speak about. But I know, Anne-Marie, you probably have a totally different idea, which I'd love to hear.
Oh, yeah. There are so many areas of inspiration. I think confectionery is a big one and how big they do the seasons. And I'm really pleased to see that stores have started to embrace a season like Halloween really throughout the store. You see bakery getting into it, flowers getting into it, all these different areas. And of course, if we even look at the frozen food aisle, which might be an unusual one, but we see tremendous strength in breakfast there as well. So I think there's just really indications that there's a lot of consumption occasions that we don't necessarily think about as it relates to bakery. But yeah, one really big one is I would say, you know, if you're on apps like Nextdoor, et cetera, I swear every other day you see people ask for recommendations for somebody that can make a wedding cake or can make a birthday cake and what have you. Yeah. And I find it fascinating. I personally live in the Publix market and Publix has a very, very strong bakery department. And it just fascinates me that Publix isn't that first stop. Why is that, right? Does Publix not offer the type of items that people are looking for? Or is it just a matter of reputation? And I think that is a really, really big one for in-store bakery at traditional retailers is being known for something. And I think that's where supermarkets can really make an impact in the aisle as well. Be known for something different limited time offers and showcase the beautiful cakes that people are making and really kind of steal a page from the book of those independent bakers that do well in that area.
Yeah, that reminds me of Costco's cakes. I don't know if you have a Costco nearby, but like that's the one everybody wants at every birthday, when I got married to my husband, we had Costco cake because it's so delicious. And so they were known for that.
They're known for it, but also they've made it easy. If you're going to have a party, then you're already thinking about buying the massive amounts of solo cups, paper plates, frozen chicken nuggets, and all the other buns and all the other things that you go to Costco for. So I honestly think it's a little bit of they recognized if our cake's good, then we'll get that sale too. And a lot of retailers, the bakery is just hoping for that sale. And then they're not even incenting the deli catering or the paper goods, which are seen, whether they're more expensive or not, they're just seen as more expensive by the consumer. Right. That's actually a recent study I also did, which was looking at in June when someone orders a sheet cake from a retailer. Here's all the other things in the basket that are food that those departments are going to lose out on if you don't incent them to get the cake from you. Yeah. And I think it's quality and it's being known for something. Bakery is such an unfortunate afterthought for most retailers. And it's obviously hard to then come up with marketing dollars and creativity and innovation if you're an afterthought. But a big piece that both Anna Marie and I talk about extensively is to your point about Costco, Jenny. It shouldn't be. It's such a unique consumer and occasion and has such white space opportunity with more consumers and occasions. There could be, again, if a retailer decided to be different and be known for something and then connect Baker to the rest of the store, I think the dollars, we'd all be studying them and talking about them a year from now, I'll tell you that.
So I have one additional question here before we have to sign off, because it affects me personally. So I use e-commerce. That's what I do. What role do you think they're going to have in 2022? Because one of the things that we've talked about as a group here is that people are inspired by what they see, right? Like we talked about non-bread and how they're doing a great job in store of inspiring people. I don't get inspired by that stuff because I'm doing it online. What role do you think e-commerce will have in 2022, Anna Marie?
Well, it's really interesting you bring that up because anything that is impulse, we see under indexing online. To your point, you're not thinking about it. So think about cherries and how short that cherry season is. What do retailers do? They put it right at the beginning of the store as you walk in. A lot of times that's where bakery sits as well. So you have to walk past bakery and not give in to the temptation, but at least you're seeing it. If you order online, to your point, you're not seeing all of that. So it is really using some of those cross-merchandising techniques, making sure it is visible to people. But yeah, it is one of these areas where I think there can be tremendous growth. Obviously, from old days, we always saw that catering opportunity where people were able to pick up the phone. So I think they're getting decent business that way. But it's really that more of occasional purchase where retailers have an opportunity to grow.
The majority of retailers that we work with, it is near impossible to isolatedly find fresh bakery cakes and bread online. And when you find them, they're mixed in with a million other options from other aisles, because all that's done is a keyword search. So I think it is exactly what Anna Marie said about impulse and using banner ads and inspiration and recipes. But I also think we've got to make sure the items are even offered.
Yeah. I mean, I would use that. Like, do you want fajitas? Click on it and it orders me all the things. You know, I think that would be incredible. Thanks, ladies, for joining us. We are out of time. I appreciate your insights. It's been great.
Thank you so much.
We know from history, crisis creates chaos, which then creates opportunities.
That's right. I'm excited to see what happens in 2022.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's all the time we have for today. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and follow us on thecorebeyondcut.com and thebakerstape.com. Till next time, preserve what matters.